Have you ever heard a painting scream before? When you stand in front of it, you can hear it scream in anguish, shout in despair, grovel for your attention. The scream is guttural, primal. It is as if the figures in the paintings are being trapped in their own canvases, desperately asking for your help. They look like humans, but you're not sure. They could be expired pieces of meat or piles of human skins waiting to be worn from the charity shop clearance bin, like discarded shadows of our own human existence. You can hear the howling. You can almost smell the bodily fluid. You can feast on the sensory explosion, yet you can relate to it in every disturbing way. It is because you've loved someone before, you've bathed in shame, you've mourned the death of relationships. I'm going to tell you how this artist came up with this, how he mulled over our darkest desires and deepest fear, why he painted us like pieces of burnt bacon, and how you could enjoy his work more because of this. This is Bacon Painting Bacon. Hi, I'm Pinghei Wong. Thank you for tuning in to explore the bleakest human condition with me. Now, talking about Francis Bacon, we cannot skim over his colorful yet chaotic early life. When he was a kid, he had a tough life growing up in Ireland. He had asthma, but somehow had to live with his father, who trained horses. When he was 16, he got kicked out of home for wearing his mother's underwear. He then moved to Berlin. He lived in squalor, stayed in bed seats, slept with people who were sadomasochistic and alcoholic. Life wasn't so easy on him. He was raised by animals, lived like animals, loved men who acted like animals, and naturally he would portray people around him like animals. We can see that from his painting, Two Figures, depicting an intimate moment with his violent lover, Peter Lacy. They were like caged animals screaming in agony or ecstasy, perhaps. This was a reference to Edward Muybridge, a photographer and essentially the grandfather of Jeeves, who is known for capturing motion in sequence of images like the galloping horse that laid the groundwork for movies. Muybridge's series of men wrestling inspired him on his composition and also the form of his artwork, the form of triptychs. Bacon often showed his art in three equal-sized panels that allowed us, the viewers, to experience the succession of fleeting moments in the same second. It was also the period of time he was living in. He lived through both world wars, when the first photos and films from Nazi concentration camps were shocking the world, and nuclear war felt like it could happen at any moment. Francis Bacon has seen the horrors of war up close. His art really captures that collective trauma, the screaming mouths, the exposed ribs, the tortured expressions. They are like a raw visceral scream from a society that had been through hell. Humans were tortured beasts from the underworld. Bacon's perspective as an artist was completely shaped by this violence. He wasn't fit for military service because of his asthma, but he volunteered during the Blitz, pulling bodies out of bombed buildings. By 1948, the full extent of death camps was public knowledge, and Bacon was completely consumed by it, and he poured that dark energy into his work. One great example would be three studies for figures at the base of a crucifixion, shown in an exhibition in April 1945, just a month before World War II ended. The piece shows three distorted figures, part human, part beast, screaming in anguish and radiating fury against a bold cadmium orange backdrop. They were modeled after the Furies from Greek mythologies, writhing, wailing with anger and reeking of human blood. The screaming mouth was his signature recurring motif, borrowed from a shot in the famous massacre scene at the Odessa steps in Eisenstein's battleship Potemkin. In this shot, a blood-stained woman with a pair of broken glasses was seen screaming in agony. The screaming mouth was again seen in his 1954 portrait of Pope Innocent X. The Pope in Bacon's painting looks like he's trapped in some kind of glass torture box, his mouth frozen in a silent scream. And instead of giving the Pope a grand portrait, Bacon surrounds his figures with sights of raw meat, a nod to the brutal, haunting imagery of meat painted by artists like Rembrandt. With the carcasses hanging behind him, Bacon's Pope can be seen as either a ruthless butcher or just another victim, no different from the slaughtered animal in the background. Francis Bacon was deeply concerned with the animality of people, and in his paintings, drawing parallels between human corpses and animal carcasses, he linked human bodies to pieces of meat at the slaughterhouse, to the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, who was tied and nailed to a large wooden cross and left to hang until his eventual death. The blurring of humans and animals is everywhere in Bacon's work, where humans lust after each other like animals, suffer like mythical beasts, and die like a piece of meat on the chopping board. We are all animalistic in some way, driven by our instincts, our primal needs, and our need for connection. But as disturbing as his work may seem, it wasn't just about suffering. It is also about survival. He was the one who survived after quite a few of his friends and lovers passed away and translated his vulnerabilities into his work. Bacon was told about his lover's suicide on the eve of the official opening of his career-making retrospective. Even though he was devastated, he continued to meet and greet the critics, the dealers, and the collectors. Just like the bulls in his bullfighting paintings, we could be the bloodthirsty matadors that kill, and sometimes we could be the bulls that are killed by them. But our animal survival instincts are stronger than you think. And remember, in this beautiful madness called life, sometimes the bulls win too. After all, the scream could also be a battle cry.